Hi everyone. I don't know if you guys can hear me right now. I'm trying to see if I'm on the City Mission website. I'm checking with you really quick to see if I'm here with you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We thank the Father. Unfortunately, it is always very interesting how when you try to set it up, we've been on since 6:30, try to set up the electronics, and we always run into different issues. But praise the Lord, we're gonna start our service tonight, and we are excited. We're excited for this week lesson, what God has put on our hearts, and we continue and experience God. We continue. We have been going through 6 units this far, and we're about to start a new unit, and I'm excited. I'm waiting a little bit for some people. I know we had people on Zoom. Unfortunately, we weren't able to make that work, and so I will try to keep up with your questions if you have tonight. I would really like to interact. Unfortunately, these things sometimes are the way they are, but praise the Lord, here we are now, and I'm gonna start praying for tonight. God, I come before you tonight, and I thank you, God, that contradictory to whatever technology issues we had, we continue to praise you, God. There is only one reason why we come together on this evening, why people around Kaiserslautern, around Germany, in the United States, wherever they are, whoever is connected with us, God, is watching. We are watching because we want to learn. God, I ask you tonight, put your words on my lips, and God, on the hearts of the people that are connected with us. God, I ask that this internet, these devices that we use won't be any barriers tonight, but in end effect, you will use them for your glory, God. I pray that you will use them for your glory. And God, as we enter in this new lesson, it is not about just reading a chapter. It is not about just looking at what text is in there, God, and we are flying over it and we're going over to the next one. But it is about a true, authentic experience with you. We wanna experience God. The title alone says we wanna experience you. We want to experience you, Father. And I ask the Holy Spirit, God, glorify your name tonight. And I pray for people that are being hurt by the pandemic flu, by this coronavirus that is going on, God, people that are close to us, that we know, God, I pray for the sister-in-law from Christina, God, I pray for, amen, hallelujah, hallelujah, we thank you, Father. We want to come to you. We want to come to you tonight and continue with experience God. So, tonight's lesson is called Crisis of Belief. I had a PowerPoint prepared. I wanted you to follow with me. I wanted you to be able to write things down. So I'm probably gonna talk a little bit slower. I'm gonna try to be able for you to get to have time to write the verses down and whatever we are going to discuss. I also would like you guys to comment and to share what you guys are going through. The title of tonight's unit, the title of tonight's lesson that we are going into is called Crisis of Belief. It's called Crisis of Belief, Unit 7. And even for me, in in this study of experience, God, this week, we want to look how to properly respond to what Blackaby refers to as the crisis of belief. And for him, for Blackaby, the crisis of belief is not just, or maybe a traumatic event or a life-death emergency, but it is rather part of the ongoing process continuously that we giving ourselves completely over to God's plan and to God's plan for our lives, for our family, and trusting Him that He will provide whatever provision is needed, that He will provide the way out and what He has prepared for us. So the page and the first one for tonight is the first lesson. It's called A Turning Point. A Turning Point. And if you have your books or PDF files, please turn with me to that page. And I just want to start to say what this unit focuses on the major. It focuses on a major turning point in your life. Just that alone right there is very deep. A major turning point in your life. When God invites you to join Him in His work, He has a God-sized assignment for you. And you will quickly realize that you cannot do what He's asking on your own. If God doesn't help you, you will fail. If God doesn't help you, you will fail. This is the crisis of belief, when you must decide whether to believe God for what He wants to do through you or not. I'm gonna move this a little bit. So we got this right there. And we prepare like that. Okay, so what I would like to do first, I would like us to go into and recapitulate what we have learned this far in this Bible study. We're going back to verse, to memory verse number one. If we would have been on Zoom, we could have done an interactive study here. We could have done it together. But I'm going to repeat it. Please repeat it with me. It is in John 15:5. That is our first verse from our first unit. And it starts with, I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Amen. Amen. John 15:5. We're going to go through. And if you can and you have memorized, try to just say it by heart. Try to let it sink in. Because the verse, the word, the scripture of God has power. The scripture of God is life. The second one is in Psalm 27. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Amen. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of our Lord our God. Verse number 3. We find it in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 to 38. And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. Amen. Amen. Memory verse number 4. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Amen. We find this in John 14:21. Memory verse number 5. And by the way, guys, I'm using the ESV translation, so it might be different a little bit than what it is in the book, or however you learned it. It's a different translation. Makes no difference. We praise the Lord in the Spirit the same way. Whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God. Hallelujah. John 8:47. Verse number 6. So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, that the Son does likewise." John 5:19. And this was the last one. We were going through how God speaks through everything, and he speaks to the church, and he speaks to the Spirit, and he speaks through the Scripture to us. And a new verse today that we are taking in, and I would like to repeat it a few times. This is the new verse from Unit 7. It is from Crisis of Belief. And we can find it in Hebrews 11:6. We can find it in Hebrews 11:6. And it says, "And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever should draw near God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him." And without faith, it is impossible to please him. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For whoever would draw near God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Amen. Let's repeat it one more time. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever could draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Amen. Hebrews 11:6. And in this new lesson, this will be one of the main, and it is the main verse that will take us through crisis, the crisis of belief. We see in the book, and what we have written in here, we have seven realities. And I just would like to go back and recapitulate those realities that we have learned in the meantime. The first reality is God is always at work around you. That is a reality. That is a fact. God is always at work around you. Always. If you see him or you don't, he's there working around you, working for you, working with you. Amen? The reality number two, God pursues a continuing love relationship with him, with you, that is real and personal. God pursues a continuing love relationship with you that is real and personal. That is the heart of God. God pursues. If you don't remember reality two, the whole entire sentence I said, just remember those two words, or three, God pursues you. Why? Because he loves you. Reality number three, and this reality invites you to become involved with him in his work. Reality number three, that God is inviting me to become involved with him in his work, has had the greatest impact on me. I have thought more of working for God than working with him. I have thought more of working for God than working with him. So the realization that his purpose in this regard is a mutual effort rather than solely my response to his calling furthers the development of a personal relationship. And to see it and to realize and to have the revelation that God is working with me together. And I am working with him together. If we look at reality number four, we see that God speaks. And that was the reality that we have had the last 5 or 6 weeks that we went through, is God speaks and how he speaks through everything. God speaks by the Holy Spirit, through the Bible, through prayer. He speaks through circumstances. And the church to reveal himself and he speaks to reveal his purposes, and he speaks to reveal his ways. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And today we come to a new reality. And this new reality is God's invitation for you to work with him always. God's invitation for you to work with him always leads you to a crisis of belief that requires faith and action. God's invitation for you to work with him always leads you to a crisis of belief that requires faith and action. Every time he invites you, every time he stretches his hand out to you and he says, come, join me. Come, be my partner. Come, work with me. Come, share this joy with me. Come, let's have pleasure together in the works that are standing before us. That will lead you to a crisis of belief. And that crisis of belief that it leads you into it will require faith in action. So we had the first one, God's work, the relationship, the invitation. God speaks, and now we had crisis of belief. So what is crisis? What is crisis? I mean, the word crisis comes from a Greek word that means decision, and it means judgment. A crisis of belief is not a calamity in your life, but a crisis of belief is a turning point where you must make a decision. You must decide what you truly believe in God. At this point, at this crossroads that come in your life, you have to decide, what is it that I truly believe? What is it that I truly believe in God? So the way you respond at this turning point will determine whether you become involved with God in something God-sized that only he can do, or whether you will continue to go. And I don't know who I'm talking to. Maybe you are going through these things right now. I don't know if you are going through these life struggles right now, what the crossroads are, but wherever you are right now, it is a point where you have to decide, do I get involved with God in something that is God-sized, that only he can do, or do I continue to go my way and I miss what he has purpose for my life? And this is not a one-time experience. In matter of fact, it is a regular occurrence. This thing, the way you live your life, is a testimony of what you believe about God. So the way you live your life is a testimony what you believe about God. And we see that in the things that we read, in the turning point in our lives, God is there waiting for us to decide. He will not push us. He will not trouble us, but he lets us decide what we want to do. So the way I live my life is a testimony of what I believe about God. The way I live my life is a testimony of what I believe about God. In Exodus 4, verse 10 to 16, and it says, when God tells me what he wants to do through me, I'll face a crisis of belief. And you will get to this point in your life where you're going to think how you're going to move forward. I had a few crises of belief in my life. I had a few places where I had to decide, God, in which direction am I going to go? In what decision am I going to make here? It's been sometimes fearful moments, sometimes There were painful moments. And I can tell you, as we are going to go deeper and we're going to read some passages of scriptures, we're going to go in and see what the scripture is telling us about this crisis of belief. We're going to see what the Bible is teaching us in this direction. And I just want us to open up the Bibles, and then later on I will also do a small testimony about me. I want to, just so you see, and I would like to hear from you. I want to hear from you, and in the matter of fact, you can take this with you. I want to hear from you a crisis of belief, what you have been going through that I can share here, or if you are going through a crisis of belief right now. So if we open up the Bible to Joshua 6, verse 1 through 5, we read right there where Joshua is actually crossing over to take the people into Canaan. And the first thing they need to do, in the first battle they are going to fight, is against Jericho. So Jericho, the Amorites were living there. The Amorites were giants. In matter of fact, we know the story with the witnesses that went there, with the people, with the spies that went in there. In matter of fact, 10 of them, they said they look like giants and we look like grasshoppers next to them. So we know how big, we know how dangerous they could be. And so we are entering here in chapter 6, where Joshua is standing in the presence of the fortress of Jericho, and God is speaking to him. So Joshua 6, 1 through 5, it says, "Now Jericho was shut up inside and outside because of the people of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have given Jericho into your hand with its king and mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all the men of war going around the city once. Thus you shall do for 6 days. 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. And on the 7th day, you shall march around the city 7 times. And the priests shall blow their trumpets. And when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, when you hear the sound of the trumpet, then all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city will fall down flat. And the people shall go up, everyone straight before him.'" Man, as I was studying this, as I was trying to put myself in the situation, I was trying to see what Joshua had to tell these people. And in Numbers 26:51, in Numbers 26:51, it tells us the number of the men that were going into the promised land. And I think it was around 601,000. Around 601,000. The Jewish people just counted the men. So with wives and children, I mean, it was around 2 million people, maybe 2.5 million people. It was a country that was going to Canaan. We see that number that was going to the promised land. This is 40 years later than when they received the promise about Canaan and walking into it. And this is their next chance. This is their chance for the 40 years promise right now to walk into it. And imagine Joshua the general just standing in front of this multitude. I can't even imagine how big the sea of people was. And he's standing in there in front of them. And he tells us, "Hey guys, you just gotta follow me, walk behind me, and we're gonna go every day for 6 days, one time around this fortress, and then on the 7th day, we're gonna go 7 times and we're going to blow the trumpet and we're going to take the city. Do you think some questions came up? Do you think there were some things? I mean, we read this. We know the Bible story. We read it. We are used to it. We understand it. But would you tell an army to follow you in walking around the city, expecting the walls to fall down at the blow of a trumpet? When God invites you to work with Him, He will give you a God-size assignment. He will give you a God-size assignment. That was a crisis of belief for Joshua and for the whole entire Israel population, for the nation. So they had to decide at this point, what are we going to do? They had to decide at this point, what are we going to do? Are we going to believe God? Because when we think about them, we might think all of them were good Christian people. They all believed God. They didn't have any issues. No, it wasn't like that. Matter of fact, they had fights. They had sins. They had all kind of stuff that they were going through it. And unbelief. I mean, a lot of people died for mutiny, for rising up, for not respecting God's people. We have a whole entire history what they were capable of. So now he's standing there and they have to decide. Though they had just seen God dam up the Jordan River for them to cross. There was another miracle. There he just dammed it up for them to cross the Jordan River. This next step required faith. God told them and asked them, what will you do? So we see that the army was to walk around. Jericho was a fortress. And we see that it says the wall of the city would then fall down flat. It will then fall down flat. The crisis of belief is Jericho could be attacking them anytime, right? You're talking about the Canaanites. You're talking about people that a whole entire thing was stirred up in Israel. When the spies came back and they were saying what they saw, the fear that was created by what they said, these people are sitting right there thinking about what these guys said. They are thinking about these giants, you know, Amorites. In Amos, he talks about being like 10 to 30 meters tall. I don't even know. I don't think we want to exaggerate, but they were big. And all they had to do is just walk around and blow the trumpet. So we see that the generation that was with Joshua had to decide a difficult thing. And they did it. In that crisis of belief, they decided to believe. In that crisis of belief, they decided to bank on faith. And they believed the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They believed that God will pull them through to the other side. And it was amazing. The walls fell down. And in matter of fact, in some areas, it was like a ramp for them to run over and take the town. And they destroyed everything in there. In matter of fact, the one area where the poor people was and the prostitute Rahab was living, in that area, that part of the city remained intact like God promised. And she was saved. In matter of fact, she is in the genealogy of Jesus. Jesus was born out of that genealogy, out of that seed coming from that woman. So we see how in that crisis of belief, they chose to bank and have faith in God. You know, when we read the stories, sometimes we cannot personalize them. I remember 2 years ago, And in fact, maybe I started a little bit earlier when Emma and I, we had our daughter that went to be with the Lord when she was born. The crisis of belief didn't come then. In fact, God has given us the strength and the comfort at that time to deal with it. I mean, the Holy Spirit encouraged us. It was an amazing moment. I cannot explain it. It was hard and wounded in the heart. Or there were wounds. Of course, it was heartache. We were crying, but we had the Holy Spirit that would comfort us during this time. I cannot explain how He gave us the strength and the mighty power. But throughout that year, we needed healing. So I was successful where I was in my job. I was a project manager for an engineering firm, and we were also building our house at the time with projects that were going on. And the thing is, we knew that we needed healing. We've been wounded. We trusted in God. We believed God. Noelle was our first fruit. She went to be with the Lord. But we needed healing in this time. And so we decided to go to the Bible school. Now, mind you, you go into the Bible school, even if you go for 1 year, you're leaving everything behind. So we were in the middle of building our home, our house. It was a building project. In the middle of a very good company in Austria. I mean, in Graz, it has a very high reputation. I was blessed and privileged and honored to work there and to have a very good, secure financial status and where I was. But something drove us inside. It was a huge move. We didn't know what we were going into. We didn't really know what we were going into. And I remember looking at Emma and knowing what she's going through and knowing she needs to get away from that. She needs to recoup. She needs to rehabilitate. She needs to be restored. I knew the sacrifice it would bring. And we made the decision. As a matter of fact, I went to my boss. I went to the company, human resource and everything. And I told them I want to take a year sabbatical, coming back in a year and everything. They all told me, Danny, you crazy. You can't leave just your projects behind. You are in the middle of the projects. I had some big, big projects. It created a big issue because I had to turn them over to a project manager that wasn't involved in that. Some of these projects I've been on for 2-3 years. And, you know, at that time I was all, let's go, let's do it, let's do it. All the paperwork was signed, everything was done. About a month before we should take off, everything hit me. Everything hit me from left and right. What are you doing, Danny? You are leaving the comfort of your home. You are leaving a brand new house that's supposed to be done, finished in December. We're supposed to move in there. Our friends, our family was there in Graz. You are leaving a completely really good job. We've been working here for 4 years. You have an unrestricted, unlimited contract and security. And so I cannot tell you, in this month before we went to ETS, before we went into the theological seminary, the fights that I had as a father in the household, as a husband in the household, as responsibilities on my shoulder to provide, to make sure the finances are there, to make sure that Emma and Nathan were safe, to make sure that they had a place to stay. And so, you know, we are going into the unknown. And I cried. There was many times I'm like, God, am I doing the right thing? Do I have the confirmation? Am I doing the right thing of what we believed this is what it is? We had people that encouraged us, but we had people that came and said, hey, this is not for you. You shouldn't go there because you don't need more theology. You don't need that stuff. You just let the anointing flow. And so it was not an easy moment. I had no aspiration. We had no aspiration at the time to go into full-time ministry, really, or to become pastors. That was not our goal. But it was a God-sized assignment. And What happened in that year, starting in January 13th, throughout the year up to August 31st, when we moved in those 8 months, was a crisis of belief that has happened in that time. And I thank God that He gave us the strength to choose in this time to make the right decision and to trust in His provision, to trust that He is going to carry us through, to trust that we're going to receive the healing. And in fact, we went there. We thought we are going to receive and receive and receive. But we were like the oldest ones there. We were established people. We were a couple that were ready. We were like the parents of these young students that were there. And our healing didn't come by receiving, but it came by giving. By giving, by praying, by being there for other people. And this is how our journey started. This is the reason why we are at City Mission today. Because in that crisis of belief, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we were able to make, I believe, today, the right decision. And has that stopped? Has that crisis of belief stopped? No, it's a continuous occurrence. Like I said it before, it's an occurrence that will take again. And you start from step one again, as we were talking. God works continuously. God works continuously around you. Wherever you are, whatever you do, He works continuously around you. Right now, as we are speaking, He is at work. And if you just graduated from a crisis of belief, maybe you went into adjustment, adaptation. That will be the next unit, adjustment, adaptation. And then we're going to working with Him, partnering. But these things are powerful. So in the right time to make the right decision, and He will guide you. And we continued in this decision. We continued to go forward in this crisis of belief. We, you know, for a moment, we had a break. We aligned. In the fact, we really had to decide what we want to do. That year came to an end. And instead of going back after the sabbatical year, I went back and I quit. God has called us into full-time ministry. In that 1 year, God has changed, He restored, He did a lot of work in us that we could never imagine. We look back and we couldn't have planned it. We couldn't have chosen it. We couldn't have decided. So I just, as I'm moving forward, and if time allows, I still want to talk about Gideon tonight. And if time allows, I would like to share some more from my life. But there was crucial times. There were crucial nights. I remember one time I went to a prayer meeting like 2 weeks before we had to go. And I believe that whole entire night for like 2.5 hours, how long the prayer meeting was, I just cried and I just declared, God, I believe in You. God, I declare. God, I believe. God, I know that You are with me. And I had to scream it out. I had to yell it out. I had to proclaim it. And guess what? After those 2.5 hours of warfare, I had that peace and freedom. I knew I took the decision, the right decision at the crossroad. Instead of going left, instead of going right, I just went straight with God's help and God's promise that He will be with me. He will never forsake me. He will never leave me, but He will be with me through everything and everything that I go through. And so that has been one of the crises of beliefs in my life. But I can tell you, as a son and as a daughter of God, you're going through these things. And you will find out what you believe in. You will find out what you believe about your God. You will find out who your God is. And you will trust Him that He's the provider. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father. You know, Miles Monroe says, and I love Miles Monroe, I quote him a lot. He says, what you see as a crisis, God sees as an opportunity of growth. What you see as humiliating, He sees an occasion for the development of humble leadership. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? It is all in how you see it. What is your perspective? What is your perspective? Seeds of faith are always within us. Seeds of faith are always within us. And sometimes it takes a crisis to nourish and encourage their growth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You just got to speak it. I see that Cassie Owens, she wrote, amen. Faith comes by hearing. We got to speak God's truths out loud and really hammer it in. Amen. Amen. Faith comes by hearing, and by hearing the word of God, praise the Lord, they will give you the strength and the power to go through it. You know, we see Gideon. Guys, man, I was going into this story with Gideon. And Gideon is sitting up there. He's there with 32,000 men. 32,000 men. And the Midianites, we read in Judges chapter 8, verse 10, we read that there were the Amalekites and the Midianites. They were 135,000 strong. 135,000 strong. It says in Judges 6:33, now all the Midianites and the Amalekites and the people of the east came together, and they crossed the Jordan and camped in the valley of Jezreel. And then we continue in Judges 7:1-8. It says, then Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, they called him Jerubbaal because he destroyed the altar of Baal. He destroyed the altar. And he's like, the one that defeated Baal, their God. That's the name they gave, Jerubbaal. And all the people who were with him rose early and then camped beside the spring of Harod. And the camp of Midian was north of them by the hill of Moreh in the valley. The Lord said to Gideon, the people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand. The people with you are too many to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Now therefore, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead. The people who are with you are too many for me. Isn't that something? God is telling Gideon, the people that are with you are too many for me. Why? Because I don't want Israel to boast that they took the Midianites through their own strength, through their own power, through their own doing, through their own works. On how many times we think in our crisis of belief that we do certain things, and because we did these things, these works, these performances, we have gone through that crisis of belief. And we forget that God was always there, that guided us and led us and put things in our way, in our path to come out of it. Hallelujah. So this was a great testimony. This was a great test for Gideon. Like I said before, his army was 32,000 men strong. And we have 135,000 Midianites. They were already in a position, if you calculate, 4-1. So that means that one Israelite would have to fight against four of them. And then the God thought that army was too big. And he commanded Gideon, everyone that's fearful, everyone that has fear, to go away, to go back home to his house. I do not think Gideon thought or even crossed his mind the number that would leave the troops. It was 22,000 men strong. I think he was shocked. So from the 32,000, he remained with 10,000 men. And so if you go from 32,000 to 10,000 men, now you got a man fighting 14 soldiers. It's 14-1 the ratio of the Midianites. And you see that it increased it tremendously. And then God thought that his army was still too big. He looked at him and he saw. Matter of fact, I want to read in the Bible what it says. Then 22,000 of the people returned and 10,000 remained. Whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead. Then 22,000 of the people returned and 10,000 remained. And what did the Lord say to Gideon? The people are still too many. Take them down to the water and I will test them for you there. And anyone of whom I say to you, this one shall go with you, shall go with you. And anyone of whom I say to you, this one shall not go with you, shall not go. So he brought the people down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, you shall set by himself. Likewise, everyone who kneels down to drink. And the number of those who leapt, putting their hands to their mouth, was 300 men. But all the rest of the people knelt down to drink water. And the Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men who leapt, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hand, and let all the others go, every man to his home. So the people took provisions in their hands and their trumpets, and he sent all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, but retained the 300 men, and the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. Imagine that. Do you know what just happened? Do you know what just happened? From 4 to 1, a ratio to 1, to 14 to 1, a ratio to 14 to 1, now the odds increased from 450 to 1. One Israeli soldier to 450 Midianites. Amazing. Just imagine this situation. Just imagine this man being there. A God-sized assignment. So we see that God wanted to get the victory. He knew he was going to get the victory. The victory that was going to be given is not going to be given to Israel, but it's going to be the reputation of Yahweh, the God of gods, the Lord of hosts, above everything and beyond. 300 against 135,000 Midianites. Mind-blowing. Imagine that today. I mean, most of you guys are in the military. Imagine the odds. And imagine that this military didn't have the right equipment. They didn't have the right. They were tent. They lived in tents. You know, they didn't have weapons like the Midianites did. So just imagine this. It is powerful stuff. You know, we look at all these things and we are trying to see, what is it, God? What is it that you want to do? If you feel like the odds are stacked against you, if you feel that your situation looks impossible, rejoice. Glorify the Father. Glorify God. Because God loves to work in these odds. God loves to work in these odds. He says in 2 Chronicles 69, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him. Isn't our Father great? Isn't he amazing? I mean, I was just studying and I was reading and I was just imagining being there. God, would I be the one running home? Would I be one of the 22,000? Would I be one of the 10,000? Would I be one of the ones that had fear? Or would I be the one that would stand and make the right decision and going forward and knowing that you are my banner? Knowing that you are my banner and knowing that you are my guide. Hallelujah. And it's so powerful. I mean, the thing is, a crisis of belief, it requires faith. An encounter with God requires faith. So Blackaby talks about this. The crisis of belief, number A, an encounter with God requires faith. B, encounters with God are God-sized. Encounters with God are God-sized. What you do in response to God's revelation, what you do in response to God's invitation reveals what you believe about God. It reveals what you believe about the Lord. And true faith requires action. True faith requires action. If you're looking at yourself and you realize that it has been years since you have acted upon the faith, since you have acted upon what God has given you, maybe you have to look and see, where are you right now with God? In what situation? And if it's a crisis of belief that you are going through, I can reassure you that God is there with you. I can reassure you that right now He's speaking to you. So, I want to read something, another quote from Miles Monroe that I really like. And he says, sometimes God will back you into a corner and take away all your other alternatives because He wants to show you His miracle working power. Perhaps you are facing a difficult situation and have come to the place where you can say, I have tried everything else. All I have now is what God has said to me. You don't need anything else, because in the Bible it says it is written. It is written. All I have now is what God has said to me. Whenever God reduces you to His word, if that's all you have to go on, you are about to receive a miracle. You are about to receive a miracle. As long as you have a scheme to fall back on, you aren't going to see that miracle. You will not be able to see it. You always have plan B. You always have another scheme. However, when you say, I can't do anything else, I don't know what to do, if God doesn't come through, I'm going under, then God says, I love this situation. I'm going to get involved in this because I love to do the impossible. God loves to do the impossible. He functions in the impossible. God's natural realm is the impossible realm. God's impossibility, God's dimension is for us where He works in the impossibility, in the supernatural. So, I like this situation, God says. I'm going to get involved in this because I love to do the impossible. If you have faith in God's word, God will take what is impossible and make it seem like an everyday thing. Hallelujah. Your blessings are not ahead of you. They are behind you. But you pull them toward you as you walk in His will. Step by step, day by day, they come. Everything you need will come. Just trust and obey, and the blessings will chase you down and overround you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And I just wanna ask you some questions. I don't know if we're about, I don't want to hold you too long, but have you had to abandon your plans to join in His work? Just think about it for a second. Have you had to abandon your plans to join God in His work? Maybe you can write something or give me a message or something. I'm trying to look on Facebook Live and see if I can answer it, or if I can just take your statement and say it. That is one thing. Have you had to abandon your plans to join God in His work? Another question I would like to ask you, and take it with you, maybe write it down. Why is it that when God invites us to join Him in His work, to accomplish His purposes, that we think, why is it that when God invites us to join Him in His work, to accomplish His purposes, that we think it's all about us, about our skills or qualifications and purposes? That's another thing. And I'm looking right now to see if anything pops up, if anybody has an answer, if anybody would like to write something. I haven't seen anything right now. And the third question I would like to ask you tonight is, what kind of crisis of belief are you facing right now? What kind of crisis of belief are you facing right now? And feel free to write something. We have a couple minutes. I would like to read some responses. If God has spoken to you tonight, if you could share some of the things that I went through, if you could share some of the things that Gideon or Joshua went through. And I just would like to leave you with this then. God is always to work. I see Cassie writing something. Oh yes, many times. Most notably giving up music school to be mama and ultimately becoming a leader to celebrate, to recover, and being invited to minister at many local places. A leader to celebrate recovery program and being invited to minister at many local places. I even got to lead worship many times. So even though I didn't get to finish music school, God still worked in me and through me with songs and teachings. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Abandoning your plans to join God in His work. You don't know what would have been. But when you took that decision to join His work, to join in God's partnership, and you accepted His invitation, I think that is the most fulfilling thing you can ever experience. Hallelujah. Thank you, Casey. I appreciate it. Appreciate your feedback. If there's anything else, I would like for you to write and share it with us. There's probably a lot of things in your guys' life, a lot of things that you went through or are going through. Remember, encounters with God are God-sized. Encounters with God are God-sized. We can't even imagine what it means. And in this time, this is the crushing. This is the crushing, the olive press, pressing the olives. This is where you make the decision. What it reveals, what you believe about your God. What do you believe about your God? Hallelujah. I'm so thankful and honored that we could share this tonight. Again, I want to apologize. Zoom didn't work. The Facebook Live didn't work. A lot of things. But what God wanted to be said has been said, and we glorify the name of God. So I would like to thank you all for watching, and I would like to pray, and that we come together in prayer and glorify the Lord. God, thank you, God, for your God-sized assignment in my life. God, I pray right now, what is the God-sized assignment for City Mission? I pray for your revelation for City Mission tonight and for the people, for the body of Christ that is present here, God. I pray that you reveal and that you speak to your body of Christ, that you speak to your leaders, that you speak, God, what the God-sized assignment for this is. We need to look past things. If we can do it in our own power, God, then it is us who did it. And we need to look at you and we need to see, God, things that are impossible in a human mind, things that are impossible in the relationism that we are thinking, in the logic of our mind, God, and to cross over in the impossible, to trust in you. Give us that beacon of faith to trust in you, God Almighty. And whatever crisis of belief we might be going through, maybe as a church, maybe as the body of Christ, maybe as individual, I pray right now for your wisdom, God, to make the right decision, to decide the right path, to decide where and what we are going to do. Are we going to believe in your word? Are we going to believe in the scripture? Are we going to believe you, or are we going to back out, God? God, I pray that in this time, the greatness of you, the strength of you in our heart will be revealed, and that we choose to trust you, that we choose to believe you. You are an amazing Father. You are an amazing God. And I thank you for all the opportunities we have had, for the opportunities that will come. And I pray, God, that at the right time, your Holy Spirit tells us what we need to do so we can decide not for us, but we decide for the extension of the kingdom. We decide for you and we decide for our partnership. God revealed to us that this partnership is an honor and a privilege, that it is the most expensive gift we have received. This partnership was the highest price everyone could pay for. This partnership has costed you everything. This partnership, God, this partnership costed you your life. And I thank you for that. Thank you for your invitation. I love you, Jesus. And I praise you. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Thank you for watching. God bless you. Bye-bye. In Jesus' name. Amen.